morning.
Good morning. Let me get my thing.
My thing. Yeah. Are people on the front row? You're in the spit zone, right?
Uh-huh. Especially Jose.
Well, we're going to start with some music. You want some more? Okay. This morning. Hi everybody, I'm Alex, in case you didn't know me. I have been playing violin for over 20 years, nearly 25 years now, so you'd expect I should have done more practice. I came home one day when I was nine, and I just told my parents, hey guys, I've started playing violin. That was cool. I also play guitar, I also sing, and for most of my life I've been organized or involved in orchestras or bands or choirs. I'm always singing, always dancing, always playing music. I have a day job as well. That's for a company called Bredex here in Germany. I am head of test consulting there, and I'm also a product owner for an automated testing tool that's in the open source space. So those are my two sides of who I am. Hype, who are you?
This is me. Hi, I'm Hype. I come from the Netherlands. I'm a context-driven agile software tester. I played trombone. I was an autodidact. And a friend of mine who was in a brass band said, hey, we lost some people, and you want to play? I said, yeah, sure, why not? So I bought a thing, didn't know how to play, started blowing in it, spitting in it, and then all of a sudden it made a, well, sort of a sound. So I tried that for 10 years, and about 7 years ago I started taking lessons, and, well, that really improved. My playing.
There's a lesson to be learned from that, right?
I was a bit shaky, so yeah. Oh yeah, and I'm a rapid software testing teacher since this year, so I'm pretty proud of that.
Okay, so why are we here? Well, the story actually goes back to agile testing days last year in the bar at about 4 o'clock in the morning.
Keep sliding.
When Hype and I discovered after, there was a couple of beers, maybe a couple more beers, when we discovered that we both have a huge passion for music, and that he plays trombone and I play violin. So this idea was born that music and testing, there are parallels, there are things we can learn one from the other. So for us, music is everywhere. Music affects everything that we do in our life. We listen to it, it affects our emotions, our memories, it has an effect on how we're feeling at a specific time. It can evoke things from a different time or from films. We'll get to that. So it's important for us. It's also a very complex thing. Who actually plays an instrument? Don't worry, we won't use this information against you. Yes, we will. So people who play instruments will know that it's complex and it's fun and it's difficult. It's also very, very social. You get together to play music. We've got some excellent examples of that later. It's about learning as well, and how you learn an instrument and how you learn music. There's a lot of things we can take away from that for testing and how we deal with things in our agile teams. It's also very individual. Everyone experiences it in a different way, and we've got some experiments for that as well. So that's why we're here, and what do we want to do with you guys? Hype?
Our goal today is to take you on a journey into music, because that's what Alex said is our big passion, but testing and agile is also our passion. So what do these two have in common? We're here to entertain you, give you some insights, and well, maybe help you learn while doing that. But I think you guys are a little bit quiet.
I think everyone is kind of quiet this morning.
They're hungover from speaker
so?
Dinner and stuff.
Yeah,
a little bit shy, all new. Who's new at this conference? Ah, you didn't, you really don't know what you got yourself into.
If so, you haven't already gathered. Should we do some singing?
Yeah, let's. Stand up, everybody,
stand up,
please.
Everybody. This is the audience participation part. Hype, can you give me the notes or the text?
Sure.
Okay. It's super easy. I'm going to sing it for you, and then you're all going to sing with me, and nobody is leaving until everyone is singing. Okay. Give me an F. You sure that's an F?
No, it's not an F. That's an F.
I'm not believing you.
Are you sure?
Yeah.
You see, lack of practice. That's an F.
I can't sing that low. I know I was in the bar last night.
Sorry.
Good Rose. Oh, thank you.
Welcome.
I broke it again. Okay. Rose, rose, rose red, will I ever see thee wed? I will marry at thy will, at thy will side. Come on.
Rose, 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 rose red, will I ever see thee wed? I will marry at thy will, at thy will side.
One more time.
Rose, 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 rose red, will I ever see thee wed? I will marry at thy will, at thy will side.
Hey, everybody, give yourself a round of applause.
Very well done.
But don't sit down yet. Oh, no. No, so, no, no. No sitting down. Lady in the front row.
So, okay, can we spice it a little bit up?
Yeah, it feels a bit... Right, so now we test if the microphone is going to work, so... Hit it. Are we getting it?
And again. And again. Is it on? I didn't quite understand it first, you know what I mean?
Okay. So, do you know what the funny thing is? The hit the road jack, this really cool riff, this bum, 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 bum. That is going to work awesome. Really brilliantly with this rose red. Now, this time, please start it on F. Rose, rose, rose red, will I ever see thee wed? I will marry and I will at thy will side. Come on. Rose, rose, rose red, will I ever see thee wed? I will marry and I will at thy will side. Dance. Rose, rose, rose red, will I ever see thee wed? I will marry and I will at thy will side. Ah, you did good. You can sit down.
Awesome.
Everyone's like, I did not sign up for this. Is everyone awake now? All at the back? Excellent. Okay, let's get down to some. Oh dear.
You seen these? They're awesome.
Yeah.
They have plenty.
It's going to be fine.
Okay, let's talk about music and learning.
Okay, so the thing with music, and you noticed this just a second ago, right? Instant feedback. If something goes wrong, you're like, oh no, that didn't sound right. It's important to get used to those feedback cycles when you're a musician. There's none of this waiting for like 24 hours or 4 days until you get your music back and you're like, oh yeah, you hear it. As soon as you play something, you hear it. And if it's horrible, you notice it. Hype.
Let me take you back 10 years, maybe 15 years. I just got this thing, you know? And I was like going like, and then all of a sudden it did like, and I was like, ah, wow.
I feel really
so I started trying to play scales.
Okay, because you can hear that you can't do it.
Well, I've got 3 right out of 4.
You can learn from that.
I think you get the idea, right?
So this idea of instant feedback, that is something that we can definitely take away. As soon as you hear that it's bad, you can change it. And there are ways once you're a musician, especially on the tubey squeaky thing. What is that called?
This
tubey
thing.
Squeaky thing?
It's a guessing stick.
So you can adapt while you're playing to make it better while you're still playing. How else do we learn music?
Well, as in testing and software, music is really can be really complex. So if you have to play a really complex piece, you don't just start at the front, go to the back and try it. You, well, like rip it apart. So can you give me something complex?
Sure.
Something
on the basis that I can still play it.
It's obvious that you can't do that at once. So what you do is you start nice, slow, and easy. Take all the complex stuff out.
Okay.
So then you add some triplets in it. And then on a violin, if you touch the strings, two strings at the same time, we call it double stopping. Can you add those? Awesome. And then just speed it up. Faster. Come on, you can do it faster. You see? That's how you learn. Well done.
So now, as much as my dad and my old violin teacher would be really proud of me for saying this, but the thing is, you've really got to get your fundamentals down before you can start doing things like that. It would be lovely just to start doing that without having any fundamentals whatsoever. In music, your fundamentals are your scales. Hype, can you play a scale?
Sure. Starting on an F?
You start on whatever you want, sweetie.
Something like this? Or can you do it for me, please?
I could try.
Okay.
So I'm gonna
I'll play along.
Okay. I'm gonna go in G. What are you doing?
No, I want F.
Well, this isn't gonna work. Should we want me to do F?
Yeah.
Okay. What was that?
I was one note behind, sorry.
So
I can do it.
So the thing with these fundamentals is that once you've got them down, then you can do some really quite interesting stuff as well with music. So we're going to get later on to the idea that music isn't just what it's written like on the paper. But if you have something, so I'm going to go into G scale. Can you put the thing up?
Sure.
So there's a tune, a folk tune called The Irish Washerwoman, and this is how the notes often get written down. I'll play it in a second. But it's in G. So if I know my G scale and my G arpeggios, then I know I can do all kinds of crazy stuff with this. This is how it's actually written here. That's okay, you know, but I could also do, or even something like, and all kinds of other things, just because I know that that's a G scale, and I've, at some point in my life, practiced that G scale. So I can do those things. So having those fundamentals is going to make you be able to explore and do more exciting things, even though actually practicing the fundamentals can be kind of boring sometimes.
Mm-hmm. So, and there's also a thing called muscle memory. As I told you, this is a guessing stick. A violin is easy. You just put your finger in the right spot.
Seriously?
And it makes the right and it makes the right tone.
Are we going there?
But here, you just have to guess where you have to be.
You don't hear that at all, Hype.
Sorry. So first position, second position, third position is easy because you just put your finger there, and that's okay. And then you can use your thumb here, but then it's 5, 6, and 7, and don't go too far because it fall off. And to practice and practice and practice and over again, you train your muscle memory. So you just, while playing, you know exactly where to go. You don't have to think anymore.
And that kind of saves you when you can't think about anything else. I was at a talk last week at EclipseCon. Is Tobias here? Did he make it? Hey, Tobias. And he was talking about muscle memory and how when you're tired and exhausted or not thinking straight, that your muscle memory is what saves you in testing as well. So awesome stuff. And Hype said this a little bit before. When we take a piece of music, if I'm learning a new piece of music, I do not start at the beginning and just go straight through to the end. Music is split up into different areas, especially if I've played in orchestras, especially if it's a classical piece of music. There'll probably be some nice tuney bits at the beginning, some melody, and everyone can play that and everyone loves it and everyone really enjoys playing that bit. And then there's the really, really difficult parts that nobody likes playing. So you don't just start at the beginning and work your way through and see how it goes. You split it up into things like, which are the complex bits? Which are the bits where it's a junction from maybe a time signature or a key signature? Those are particularly different. And on the violin, anything that's up here sounds like dying cats. if it does, even after practicing.
I have that on my trombone. It's really, when you have to go to the sixth and seventh position.
Yeah, so anything
really
high,
you're
talking about tours, right? So yeah. Anything that's a tour of the music, if it's on a violin, you're going to do the skyscraper tour. Everything that's really, really high, that's something you're going to want to look at specifically, but on the trombone, right?
Yeah, I go low. So
if you go low, so
that would be
deep dive.
A subway.
Subway tour.
Whatever.
So you take different tours of your music depending on what your instrument is and also on what the music is. So you never practice from front to back. Okay, it's time for you to get involved again. We are going to do an experiment.
So, I want you all to close your eyes.
Don't fall asleep.
I will take pictures while you not watching.
We'll Anyone snoring will get woken up by the thingy.
And we will steal your laptop.
Okay, so what we want you to do is close your eyes and tell us what you hear. What do you see?
Close your eyes. Don't watch. Not even you, Jose. No, Ray, don't take pictures.
Okay.
Look here, close your eyes.
Okay.
Keep them closed.
No, but first I need to know what you hear.
Yeah, sure, but they can do that with their eyes closed.
What do you see? Shut up. James Bond?
Do you see James Bond? Really? How does he? What does he look like?
Sean Connery, okay.
Sorry? Oh, cool. Awesome.
So, okay, that's cool. Our hypothesis is working so far. Now, listen to this. What did you hear then? What do you see?
Hobbits.
Hobbits.
Okay,
awesome.
Anyone else? Sheep, lambs, Gandalf?
Scottish Highlands.
Whiskey.
You hear whiskey anyway. So our hypothesis, you can open your eyes now. Our hypothesis was, and that has been borne out now at two conferences, thank you, is that things where we have a shared understanding, we will see or hear the same things, right? Everyone who's seen James Bond will hear that music and know it. Now, it's funny because at Agile Testing Days Netherlands, we had a similar thing. That piece is called The Wild Asparagus. It actually has nothing to do with The Hobbit. But we have a shared cultural understanding of, oh, that sounds kind of like it's to do with countryside, or it's in a major key. Actually, it's not in a major key, it's in a minor key. But it sounds kind of nice. It's a waltz. Some people had dancing at Agile Testing Days Netherlands. But we don't have a completely shared understanding of it because not everyone knows that tune and associates it with something. So we're looking at pure system one thinking. As soon as we have a way of associating something, we're going to make that connection. And the lesson that we want you to take from that is your teams have a tune as well. Your teams have soundtracks. And if everyone associates the same thing with the same things, then it's going to make communication a lot easier. So if you have new people coming into your teams, or if something changes, then make sure that everyone's seen the film and knows the soundtrack, because then you're going to make that connection so much more quickly and it will make communication more easy.
And for yourself, just sometimes don't do anything. Sit back, look around you. What's happening? How fast is your team? What are they doing?
Yep.
What are their interests? Listen to to your team.
Okay.
So, talking about teams.
Yeah.
Who's, huh?
Who invited Bart. This guy?
Bart, what are you doing? We practiced this.
I found this really cool instrument.
Get off stage. Get off. No.
I thought I could play
Go
it.
Away now,
I'll
please. I know. It's hard. Cool. I know. It's I know. Cool. Come on. Go away. Please. Please. No, no. You'll have your moment of fame, okay? Not now. What you just witnessed is what we call the hero complex. It's when you're, sometimes you're just the triangle player and you have a very specific role. By the way, if you really want to become a professional triangle player, we have a link in our references.
This is a website.
Read it. So talking about agile teams, there are different kinds of teams, and let's compare them a little bit to, well, musical setups or musical teams. So if you're playing solo, well, it's pretty easy, right? You can talk directly to your clients, you can do whatever you like, you will catch the rhythm, you will decide what you play. It's all nice and easy. It becomes more difficult if you're in a trio and a quartet. But still, it's a small group of people, mostly with similar instruments, not a trombone and a violin. They
really need to put that together.
Yeah, I don't know. So by looking at each other, by feeling each other, you know each other's instruments, but still, you're depending on all the others. You can't play on yourself.
And there's no one really in charge in that kind of a situation.
No, not really. In a band, well, yeah, it becomes more complex, especially in a band with a, of course, there's a brass section in this band.
Always.
There's always a brass section in a good band. And there's different kinds of instruments, and we're starting to form subgroups in here. It's like the drums and the bass, they do the rhythm. It's like the lead guitar and the singer, they're most likely to be the leaders of the band, although there are different bands, but most likely there will be a leader. And the one who's playing the tune will decide what the band will play. They can switch, but still, most of the time there's one in charge. And in a little bit more complex band, the musicians don't do it themselves, although in every section, the violins and the cellos, they have a first player, sort of a team lead. But in front of the orchestra, there's the conductor. He decides who plays, how fast and how hard. He will just say, stop playing, and they obey. He will do this, and they will all stand up, and they will bow. It's awesome.
Orchestra is also, for me, the definition of too much work in progress, right? I mean, that's that's a lot going on at the same time. I would not want to be that guy at the front.
And then we have odd thing out. It's called sessions. Yeah. You're pretty experienced in that, right?
I'm a session musician. So I started out playing classical violin, but I've moved over the years to a lot more folk. And I've played in hundreds and hundreds of music sessions, and I still do not understand how they work. A group of people come together, you don't know in advance what people, what instruments, what level they have, and they sit down and they play from memory a load of tunes after each other. No one discusses, okay, we're gonna play this one now, and we're gonna play it three times, and then we're gonna go into the A major version of it instead. None of this gets discussed. It is absolute magic, and it is purely self-organizing. Now, you could ask which of these is like an agile team, or what are the different quality characteristics of these?
So, if you look at all these different setups, which one is more agile to you, and why? And you were talked about quality criteria. In a session, the quality criteria are probably different than in an orchestra.
You could fairly say
it's
that.
Like testing. Different team setups, different clients, different contexts. Quality criteria will change. The agility of the teams will change.
And there are things you can get away with in a session as a violinist that you definitely can't get away with in an orchestra. I mean, if you're sitting there going, okay, this is cool, I'm just gonna jam along to this or do my own thing. Conductors don't take that so well in orchestras. But if you sit in there in a session going, come on, everybody, come on, now, that's not gonna go down well either. So different contexts, right?
Cool. Talking about sessions.
So yeah, okay, I'm gonna give you a bit of a look into a session. Can you, oh, let's start the video and see. All good. This is high tech.
Yeah, working?
Okay, That's me. So what you can see in this session, we've got a load of violin players. We've always got violin players. We've got a guitar player. There's a woman at the back playing some kind of whistle. We've got a guy here playing the squeeze box. There's a banjo. There's actually a guy sitting in front of me who's playing the snare drum in a session. Why not? We've probably got some kind of bagpipey things. And I can hear in the background someone playing the spoons as well. So this looks like absolute chaos, right? If you look at it, you're like, oh, you come into it, good Lord. But it has a structure, and it has a way that we can decompose it to look at it. So the way I thought of decomposing a session, because we all know the word session, right? Testing sessions, we have a thing for that in our heads. And a session of musicians is kind of similar in a way. We get together with a charter, which is to make music, with a set of experienced people and instruments to do that. And I thought, well, how can we decompose this complexity? Well, there's a structure. What's playing? We had banjos, we had guitars, we had drums, we had all of these kind of things. Then there's the tune. Now, as a violinist, I believe that violins make the nicest tune. That might be slightly biased, but it is the case that every tune instrument, be it a banjo or a whistle or a violin or like a squeeze box, every tune instrument makes a slightly different tune. But we can always say, okay, they're playing something that is close to the tune. Then we have accompaniment. What's going on at the same time? We'll have guitar players doing some stuff, maybe some finger picking, maybe some interesting things like that. The guy on his squeeze box or on his accordion, he'll be doing chords and tune maybe as well at the same time. And then we have rhythmic aspects. So you'll have people on barans or the snare drum. I don't know how we got the snare drum into the session. But anyway, or on the spoons. And they're emphasizing patterns that come up again and again in the music, in the piece that's happening right now. So that's one way of decomposing something that's fairly complex, and mm-hmm. It occurred to us.
Yeah, well, before we go on, who doesn't know what heuristics are? Everybody knows?
Well, nobody's
So I can pick somebody random who can explain it here?
Okay,
let me sorry. Yes, I am a teacher. So a heuristic is a fallible way to solve a problem. It might work, and often it works, and especially if they have the skills to make it work, it will work. But sometimes it just doesn't work. And heuristics help us to come up with a solution quickly. It's a shortcut for your brain. Like, okay, so if I look at this heuristic of yours, if I look at a session, what's the structure, the tune? So I can quickly recognize what is happening around me. We have a similar thing in testing for that. Who knows San Francisco Depot from Rapid Software Testing? That's a heuristic to decompose the product you're looking at. This is what we call the product elements. So what's the structure of, let's say, a website? We have a front end and a back end and a database and stuff happening. What's the function? So what does it do? Which data do we use? What are the interfaces? On which platform does it perform its thing? How is it used, operation? And how does time influence on this? So heuristic to help me decompose a product really fast, to recognize what's going on in my product around me.
So yeah, when I was thinking about decomposing a session in this way, I thought to myself, maybe the next time I'm doing some testing, I'm going to see if I can decompose my testing in a similar way. I mean, they're about different things, but sometimes maybe having the analogy of music in my head is going to help me. What things are playing the tune? What's going on in the background? So maybe try out that star thing as well if you're musicians. Okay, we're still in the context of teams, but I want to take a brief sachet into musical theory. How many of you are musical theorists? Okay, I'll be nice.
Okay.
Okay, also, don't find my errors. So you might think that if you have an E note, which I guess I could play just for the fun of it, if you have a note
that is
better
E, than you do it.
You might think that...
You see, on a violin it's easy. Told you.
And then she hit him with the violin. So you might think that that note means the same thing all the time, right? It's an E. Well, that's not quite the case. If you have an E major scale, the E is what we call a tonic. So if you finish something on an E in the context of E major, that is going to sound done, and it's going to sound finished, and it's going to sound like that was supposed to be the way. If you have an E in the context of G major, then that is going to sound, well, it's a sixth, and the sixth has a specific meaning in scales, because that is, we call it the relative minor. And we've got two really nice examples of that, and we're going to hope that they are loud enough. If not, I'm going to have to do some pretty good...
So be really quiet. Everybody, we have some really trouble with quiet. The sound on this laptop.
Okay, you guys ready?
Okay, let's do that again.
Okay. Could you hear that enough? I could, standing in front of the computer. So I'll play it just briefly. It was reading the key signature is a good idea. Sounds done right. We call that an authentic cadence. Let's move on to something that we call a deceptive cadence. Ooh. Can you play that again?
Sure.
You guys hear that? So the interesting thing here, now for those of you that don't read bass clef, what is happening here is this is our E. This is that same E that we had before, but in the context of this G major, it makes it into an E minor chord, and an E minor in G major, everyone's gonna fall asleep, but this is relevant. The idea is this makes it sound like it's not done. And this is used a great deal across a lot of Western music, definitely. And we associate this with various things. So the context of something is incredibly important. So we could ask ourselves, which one would you rather have at the end of your sprint? Would we rather have that? Or
let's have a beer. What? Steel bugs?
This is the typical, yeah, it's going to be done, it's going to be done, it's going to be, it's not actually done. No, okay, so the laughing means that that's not just me that knows that, okay. So which one of them sounds like the bug that you just found that you weren't expecting to find, right? So know what your cadences are. I know that people aren't necessarily always singing in stand-up, although that would be an awesome idea. You could sing about what you did yesterday and about your problems. That's going to be a cool thing. But know what your cadences are. Learn how to feel how notes are playing in context and to recognize that something is maybe going to go wrong or not get done. Let's get on to testing.
Okay. So if you look at music, there are a lot of parallels with exploratory testing or testing. When you first start playing a piece of music or you start learning, you really need your sheet music. You really have to look at your script to know what you're doing. And then you start practicing, and you start learning your piece. And then all of a sudden it becomes easy to just let it go. And I remember my band leader kicking up my thing and said, okay, you're good enough now. You don't need your sheet music. And I was like, oh, I really need it. And then I could do it without the sheet music. And while I was detached from the sheet music, I was making my own little interpretations. It's like, okay, let's just, I don't know, play something different than's there. So I started improvising, which is really difficult, especially for if you have the skills, if you have my skills. But if you stick to your test script, you will never improvise. You will only find the bugs you were ever bound to find. Stepping away from your script, you will run into new adventures. You will just see stuff. You can explore. Improvise. There is also communication over documentation. And I like to compare it with writing a book. I wrote a book once with 8 people about the future of software testing, and we were done in 3 evenings creating the mind map, creating the story. We knew what we were going to write. And then it took us 8 months to get it on paper. We talked about it for 3 evenings, and we were done. Everybody knew what we were doing. Imagine me writing this keynote out on paper. It will take me hours. We can do it in an hour. So if we look back in history, people didn't even know how to print press. So they had to sing and talk to each other. And I think there's a cultural thing as well, right?
There is. I mean, in the Irish folk or in the folk tradition specifically, all of the music that was passed on by ear. It was almost never, ever written down. And so many of the tunes that I play now today and that folk musicians all over the world play, they have come through centuries of being just played, passed on, changed, adapted. People have started writing them down now so that they don't get lost. But then you end up with things like we saw for the Irish Washerwoman, which is, okay, this is how we could represent it. But the first thing that you learn as a folk musician is if you are going to read it from the music, don't play it like that. That is just how we're writing it down to keep hold of it. That is not a detailed representation of what it's supposed to be. So music's got that, it's got that going for it.
Well, just imagine yourself, there's a blues standard and everybody has to comply. Imagine yourself at a concert where there's your big rock star on stage and he said, no, you're doing it wrong. This is not how you learned it in training. There's no such thing. Blues is played different every time they do it. They just make it up. They have three chords, three tones, and they will just start playing and do it. So the only standardization in music, the only music that is standard, I think, is dead music.
That's what I think too. Okay, so music is also inherently experimental. I don't know how many times I've sat down with a piece of sheet music for orchestra and said, okay, I'm going to work out my fingering and my bowings, or maybe for you, your breathing, right?
Mm-hmm.
Breathing is important. And you say, yep, this is logical, I'll do this, and then you try it and you're like, oh no, that's not going to work. I thought I could move my first finger here and then bow like this. Just doing it a dry run is never going to help. You always have to test your theory when it comes to how am I going to actually do this, how will it feel, how will it be, and how will it sound when I actually start playing it. Experiment.
Music is also non-deterministic, and yes, this will sound strange to a tester, not really reproducible. Every time you play it, it will be slightly different. I don't know how many of you have been to Pink Floyd concerts. They're pretty close to the CD, but it's different every time.
And it's good that it's different.
Of course, that's what makes it interesting. Just, if I want to hear the CD, I will buy it and we'll put it on in my car. That's fine. If I see them on stage, I want to feel emotion. I want to see them sweat. I want to see them be humans and make little tiny mistakes that will make it easy. And people will start communicating like, okay.
Was close, that really an
close enough? You saw us do that. So, yeah. It's the only way to reproduce music is just to put it on a CD and then play it again.
And music is very much, when we learn to play something in music, it's very much about models. So if I'm reasonably good at reading notes, so I will instantly get a model in my head of how I think that's going to sound. Sadly, my models aren't always perfect. I don't have perfect pitch, and I'm not perfect at reading rhythm. Or I'll have a model in my head based on cultural expectations. We did some research for this. We were listening to music from other cultures. And that does things that we as Western musicians would never expect. So our models are based on our experience, on our culture, on what we're reading, on what we're hearing. But it's important to test those models, because otherwise you end up with this blind, okay, I think I'm playing the right thing, but you're not. I learned a piece in 5/8, which is really, really difficult because it's not a regular beat. And I had to get someone else to come in and listen, someone else to test my model, to say, okay, you're just going to keep 5, and we're going to see if I'm actually playing this, because otherwise I might be slipping into 6/8 without even realizing it, because it feels more natural. Or test your model by playing it on a different instrument. Sometimes if I can't figure it out on the violin, I'll get to the piano and play it there. Important to test your models, because you can get into the false sense of security that you're playing it right when actually you're not.
So, and we talked about heuristics and patterns. Music is ultimately heuristic. We talked about that testing is heuristic. You can't just do the same thing over and over again. Because if you do, you will find the same bug over and over again. And developers are pretty good at hiding bugs, so you better be creative in finding them. Oh, sorry.
Don't
I was
do
just
that.
Too
yeah,
fast,
I
sorry.
Just too fast. It's okay. It means that the sound guys know we're going to play a video. So it turns out that music is so heuristic. I mean, if I'm sitting in a session and I don't know the tune, I can just find out what key it's in and just play that one note. It's not the most exciting way of joining in, but if my aim is just to be able to play along right now, that's fine. If I'm playing guitar, I know that I need the chords 1, 4, and 5. That's a heuristic. It won't always work, but it will work a lot of the time. And the crazy thing is that it turns out that most, especially pop songs that we know, are written with four chords, exactly four chords. And which four chords in which order is also quite similar. So let's see if we've got sound.
Recognize this?
Yeah, let's. You want to sing along? Be my guest. We will.
My life is brilliant. My love is pure.
These guys are awesome.
I saw an angel of that I'm sure.
Song three.
People kill and people die and children hurt and hear them cry. Can you practice what you preach? Won't you turn the other cheek? Forever young, I wanna be forever young.
Song five.
I won't hesitate no more, no more. It cannot wait. I'm yours. Lipstick stains.
Go for it, hype.
On the front of my left side brains. I knew I wouldn't forget you if I could. Then I would. I'd go wherever you were. Nobody wants to see us together, but it don't matter, no. I got you.
Where's our John Kai boy?
To the place where I belong.
Song 11.
I'm the biggest fan. I'll follow you until you love me. Papa, Papa, watch it.
12.
With or without you.
Okay. The video goes on for hours.
Find it on YouTube. It's awesome. Really.
Are awesome.
It's awesome.
But okay, you said something about heuristics before.
Yeah, well, they're fallible. It doesn't always work.
Because you know I'm all about that bass.
This is not a four-chord song.
Not at all. It's a cool song, but it doesn't contain these four chords.
I love this guy.
Annie, this guy is cool.
So it doesn't. That doesn't mean that all pop songs are awful. I mean, some pop songs really are awful. But that doesn't necessarily mean it's awful because we can reduce them to that kind of a pattern. It's just fascinating that there are that many patterns. And even I'm aware of this and I don't always notice, oh yeah, this is a four chord song. Patterns are intensely powerful in music and in testing. It's what we orient to, right? So, hype.
It's about context. We talked about it. It's about using the right chords in the right context. It's like testing. Adapting to your context will make it all happen. And if you have the skills to do it, it looks really easy. Have you seen Messi play soccer? That's easy, right? The way he does it. Yes, he's been practicing since he was this big, and he practices for 20 hours a day. Now look at this. This is Madonna. This is the original video from the late 80s. This is really smooth, right? This is done in a studio. So let's look at her perform live. Give her a break. She's only young. She's trying. Her voice is not really smooth. But hey, it's a big show. It's a great show. People enjoying it. A couple of years later, doing little moves, going really smooth. Slightly different. It's the same song performed way different. But she gets better and better over the years. Okay, she learned to play how to play the guitar. That's cool. That's different.
And this is really taken down for the context, right? It's really chilled.
It's awesome. A little bit Latin in there. Okay, and then let's take it. A couple of years later. Look at this woman.
I mean, in the context of Wembley, you're not going to do the calm version, right? That's your context. Wembley Arena is probably where you're going to be like, yeah,
And if you're called Madonna and you have a body like that, you can wear a suit like that. Okay, and if you're called Jose, you can do that too, sorry.
I'm now terrified. So.
please don't.
So what lessons, we hope that you can take some lessons away that we've been saying throughout all of this. We think it's really, really important that learn your team's tune. Your team does have a tune. You have your own soundtrack. You have the way that you work with each other and the way that that harmonizes or clashes sometimes. You can learn to be aware of that. Sometimes it's very subtle, like just that one E note that is doing a different role than it was yesterday. Learn to be aware of that. Finish your sprints on a good cadence. You can hear in music when things are going to be happening. If you get used to how those patterns sound, then you're aware of it. It doesn't shock you so much anymore. And you can do that within your teams as well. You're like, the last time that we had this sound, this happened. Should we maybe try and react to it now before something else goes wrong?
Recognize your role in the team. Who are you? What are you doing? And what's your context? Again, I'll just keep hammering, yes, Bart. Recognize your role. And if you practice a lot and practice a little bit more and know your techniques and your patterns and your heuristics and your adaptum, you'll be the star in testing, in music, in anything.
Okay. We are going to. I think we have a couple of minutes. Is that cool? We thank you so much to the Agile Testing Days team, who are always up for a super laugh. If you have instruments, get them out now. If you don't, you're going to get a kazoo.
If you don't have an instrument, then we will hand you out these. It's really easy. Don't blow in them. Doesn't work. Don't suck on them. Doesn't work. Just buzz in them. Okay, let's have some fun, guys.
I feel like we may have made a mistake. So,
while you're practicing, we will just go through the notes just to make sure that everybody knows what to play. So it's the Rose, Rose, Red song from earlier.
Sure. Stand up. Everyone stand up.
Stand up. Can you do the first?
Sure. I'm going to... Let's see. If anyone has a musical instrument, they can come up on stage. You can. You don't have to. So... It's like being in a room full of wasps, people. Okay, I'm going to play the music. Can you all be quiet?
We knew it was a bad idea.
Come up on stage.
Okay, stop practicing.
So.
Take it away, girls.
Okay, so if you play the violin thing and I'll sing. Okay, so we go 1, 2. Rose, rose, rose red, will I ever see thee wed? I will marry at thy will side. Rose, rose, rose red, will I ever see thee wed?
I will marry at thy will at thy.
We are going to do something even that I think that is the funniest thing I've ever seen in my whole life.
Thank you. You're all great.
First of all, okay.
Well done. Well done.
Right. What I want now is you can keep. You're doing awesome. This is Micah, by the way, and she rocks.
Give her a hand.
So what we're going to do now is I want this side of the audience to sing or kazoo. Some of you should sing. That would be nice. To sing or kazoo with me. And I'm going to sing up. I'm going to start at the beginning, which makes sense. And then
this is my team.
The audience,
this is my team.
You are going to
You're
start
team,
at the top when I get to here. It's a round. Have I just explained that in the worst way ever? Yes.
No, it's okay.
Okay.
It will work out.
The great thing is, in a musical sense, you just keep going. You can. I think you can. Oh yeah. Okay. So you guys are with me. So we do. What was the note? Okay. Oh, it's transposed. Play it how you like. I don't think that the kazoo is attuned to anything. Yep, that's fine. So, okay. You guys are with me. Okay, ready? Rose, 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 rose. Will I ever see thee wed? I will marry at thy wed.
Will I ever see thee wed? I will marry at thy wed. Let's do it one more time.
Can we try splitting four into four?
Four teams?
Four teams. Okay.
Four teams. Okay, here we go.
I'm going to coordinate from
everything
here.
Behind this line. Your theme four and three. Team one, team three, team two. That's it to make it difficult. And team four.
Okay.
Is that okay? One, two, three, four.
You've just got to start when the person before you, everyone knows how a round works. It'll be fine. Okay. Am I still one? That's good.
You can do one.
That's good.
I will do two.
So we need, in teams three and four, guys, you've really got it. I can see you, Toby. You need to be leading them. Okay. Rose, 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 red.
Rose, rose. Awesome, guys.
You guys
awesome.
Rock.
You rock. Woo!
So I think that we are so out of time. Thank you so much, Bart, for your awesome, awesome role. If you have any questions, now would be the time to ask them.
Thank you so much. That was awesome.
So, any questions? Questions?
I think everyone is like...
No questions?
Can I just
thanks so much, guys. It was
thank
amazing.
Thank you so, so very much.
So good.
We've enjoyed being here.